point.
They think that Assad is going to bring the stability. So they're going to think that the Muslim Brotherhood will bring the stability. So they try to support the Muslim Brotherhood. They try to support Assad.
We're mixing the responsibilities of government and our responsibilities. The government responsibility is to win.
But I thought you were on the CIA.
the government's if you're talking to a general and ISIS is going to attack this freaking village and the Hezbollah is there to help you, you're going to take Hezbollah's help and you're going to save that freaking village because that's your responsibility at the time. But I'm just saying, the government's agenda,
but for a long-term solution
is weak.
But the government has also used its brain
you're not disagreeing, but you're just talking about two different things. Yes, he agrees with you insofar as when it comes to crimes against children, when this guy comes and says, I didn't know rape was not allowed because I went to Muslim schools, they didn't teach me that, and they say, okay, you're acquitted, it's okay.
That's bullshit,
you know, all of these bullshit issues that are happening that we're complaining about, these are all under the jurisdiction of the government. The government is supposed to stand up for its citizens. It's supposed to say, no. These are our laws. If you don't follow our laws, then you get prosecuted.
Yeah, yeah.
But they're not doing that. That's the problem. Once the government actually stops that stuff at the door, then our job is a lot easier because now we're just dealing with people that have been castrated anyway.
I see you guys as people who should be advising top politicians because you're the...
we're doing now is we're working at the ground level, but above us, they're working against us.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm talking about.
Well, I think that goes to something that Ali was saying. Remember, he was talking about this deference that everybody gives to people of faith. So, of course, they're not going to go to ex-Muslims or anyone talking about, you know, the problems within religion or the problems within Islam, because particularly in the United States, just professing that you're a person of faith, all of a sudden that elevates you somehow.
Yeah.
And there's all this deference given.
Yeah.
So of course you're going to go to these people of faith because that's what you see as representative of the real...
But that's
going to
stop.
It's like going to an Orthodox rabbi and saying, please tell me about the Jewish community. Right?
Yeah,
like, no, that's the Orthodox Jewish community.
Yeah. And
It's like going to a Mormon and saying, please tell me about the Christian community.
But what's interesting with Islam is no one makes the distinction that they do more so with Christianity or Judaism.
Yeah.
You know, they'll say, well, they're Orthodox, they're Reformed.
Yeah.
Oh, these people are Pentecostal, they're Lutheran. Muslims are just this big
monolith
group of
Muslims. But do you think there's going to be stability in, like,
where?
The Muslim countries before this kind of, like, either reform or, you know, the battle. If we don't win the battle of ideas, then I don't think it's gonna stop. Do you think it's gonna stop?
Yeah.
Need Ahmed
I think.
Maybe if the oil stops.
If these groups like the Brotherhood and Islamists receive less funding than the secularists and the liberals and stuff, I think that their influence would be decreasing. I don't think they're gonna be gone, but I think they're gonna be decreasing. I mean, also, like, I think, I mean, there's a high possibility that the Iraqi Secular Party might win in the next 8 years.
Are they getting any support from Western liberals?
No, of course not.
That's the problem.
Yeah,
that's a great example.
Yeah,
the way you get that kind of government is not by telling government, hey, do this. You change people's opinion on the ground so that they could elect governments.
But really,
it's only going to happen in Iraq.
But you forget that the U.S. invaded our country, so we are kind of the exception.
That's a good
because point. We have a democracy as a result of U.S.
You're
invading
welcome.
Our country.
Yeah.
About cases like Iran and other countries, they're not under U.S.
But now the U.S. has a lot to do with Iran, right? They're in there, they're... wouldn't you think that the U.S. policies should be to say, okay, if we're funding all of these things and make like supporting you and making sure security-wise and everything, and we're funding
everything... That's the best way to make sure they don't get elected because they become U.S. puppet. People were like, oh, you're not...
Talking about supporting a specific party, but you could say, if we're doing this for you, then you are not supposed to... For instance, before ISIS came along, the Shias in,
yeah,
in Iraq, they,
Maliki.
Yeah, yeah. We had a demonstration in Denmark in front of the Iraqi embassy because they supported Sharia law and the fact that you could marry children,
yeah, yeah,
and Sharia law, family law. They actually had that implemented before ISIS came along. You know,
yeah,
the Shia,
yeah, yeah,
had. So wouldn't we, like, when we're supporting them, Denmark, the U.S., shouldn't we say, okay, we want political, like in Afghanistan, we want girls to go to school. We want, you know, we want, we don't want to accept that children are married away. You know,
no,
isn't that like,
yeah,
the...
Has any Iraqi is going to come in and, like, I will provide you more security if you don't do that?
Yeah,
like, or not that, but, like, the Iran has... Iran is right there, right? The,
yeah,
Iraqi government knows,
but
that...
But Iran needs the U.S.
Yeah.
Iran cannot do,
yeah,
this,
but,
alone.
But
you have to understand this as
but
well.
But Iraqi government knows that eventually U.S. is not going to be there, right? But Iran is always going to be there at the first time. And Iran has so many bought,
yeah,
politicians.
I think that some of it has to do with even the U.S. don't want to piss off Iraqi neighbors because they don't want to get into more wars with all of them, right?
Yeah.
Because, I mean, if you're gonna say, okay, America takes a stand against Sharia law in Iraq, for example,
yeah,
then that is also a statement against Saudi, who's our neighbor, Jordan, who's our neighbor, Iran, who's our neighbor, Turkey, who's our neighbor. So, like, Iraq is, unfortunately, is in the worst place ever. We're surrounded by...
Iran has so many bad politicians.
Yeah, and also, I mean, I think because of the kind of the appeasement policy the U.S. has towards Iran, the nuclear deal and others, is that they don't want to piss off the Iranians a lot.
Yeah, exactly.
It's because of ISIS and the rise of ISIS. So now, I mean, at least the democratic policy that the Obama administration used to be that, I mean, even the reason why Assad, the red line, when he crossed the red line, the United States did not intervene. Well,
yeah,
the
one
under Obama.
The first chemical weapons one.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that I think that one of the reasons why Obama did not intervene is because he didn't want to overthrow Assad, so he will not piss off the Iranians that he was working a deal with.
Yeah, yeah.
So all of this dynamics happen, which makes it very difficult to actually make call to action. I mean, I mean, obviously, I'm not saying that there should not be a call to action. I mean, I personally actually one of my beliefs. I think that both Iran and Saudi Arabia, like, and Qatar. There has to increase sanctions on them, so they can stop funding Islamist groups around the world.
Sanctions on Iran is not gonna hurt the right wing group.
Well, I
it's
mean,
gonna
we,
help them. They would.
We can make
that.
It like, for example, in Iraq. Like, for example, I think that
you don't
we
support
should,
sanctions on Iran.
I just saw.
I support sanctions on Iran.
What sanctions did was made the far right stronger. The far right, the right wing politicians in Iran would love. Because first of all, when you have less trade with Iran, they have so much more trade power. They have so much more private entities that become the sole providers of these services.
But at the same time, people, what pisses people most off in Iran is like poverty and so on. So they would. I mean, I don't know.
I don't know if
do you think that they would say, "Oh, our poverty is a result of these sanctions, therefore we need to change our behavior."
Yeah.
Or are they going to say, our poverty is a result of these sanctions, therefore death to the United States?
The problem is that there's
the
problem
people,
is that,
the way it's
no,
yeah.
the
most
problem
people,
is that there's so many different powers within the government of Iran. What it's going to do is going to shift the balance from some people in the government of Iran to another groups of people in the government of
Iran. But
that has not
really got to do with democracy, really, because there is no democracy in Iran, right? And
but what I'm saying is that the more deals that the more trade deals is happening with the West, the more these reformists in Iran are becoming powerful. The more because they're in and the more people that have
I don't
interested
see that.
Well, that's is happening. The more people that have interested.
Iran has
private,
not executed
interest,
more people since like when Rouhani came to power, who is like supposedly to being more moderate than Ahmadinejad. He's executed more people. That
Rouhani doesn't decide who's getting executed.
No,
that's a different branch of the government.
Yeah, but I'm saying, you know,
well, because okay, but
reformists come to power.
Because Ghazali, the judicial part of the judicial part of the government is different from the presidency, right?
Yeah, but he chose him, right?
Yeah, but the thing is that this is not something that is going to happen like overnight, right? These people,
but the reformers are not really reformers.
No, it's
they're not reformers.
I mean, the difference with them and conservatives.
You have to choose between
the great evil and the
greater evil, right?
Yeah, but they're just being. Even the ones who are really reformists, we really don't know what they really feel about Velayat-e Faqih because they can't say it.
Yeah.
So we're just guessing,
and
right?
If you really are a reformist and you have the clerics are going to say who gets to run and who stands for elections.
And then you have the
look at what years of sanctions.
Iranians, they don't care that
look what
nuclear
years
power
of
is actually a threat to Israel, is a threat to the West. It is a threat.
Look what years of sanctions is. Years of sanctions of Iran. Now Iran is the most powerful threat to democracy in many countries in the Middle East.
Yeah.
So did it achieve the
But that's
results?
Because the Obama
was
for a very long time.
But I think, for example, like any group that receives funding from Iran should be banned in the Middle East. Like Hezbollah, for example. All the militias in Iraq.
No, of course.
Also, the Muslim Brotherhood, if you, including the ones groups who are here, I think that
no,
there
but
should
this,
be
the
cutting
sanctions,
of funding.
The sanctions that she's talking about is different.
But
of course, anybody with ties to terrorism should be sanctioned.
No, it's also an act of sanctions. Is that you try to control the finances of these countries. When you suspend some of these for sure accounts of the Iranian government. Because
when the people in Iran suffer, when the people, not the government, suffer, they unite with the government against us. And
but I don't care. I really am
you
done.
You don't care about the people?
I don't care because really, people, they care about their money more in
Iran.
Yeah,
but I don't think
when
people
are being
hungry
stoned,
because...
Even like... I was about
people go with the flow.
Isn't
like,
the
well, people crave security
very,
too. I mean,
very
honestly,
high
they
do.
Yeah,
like
70%.
I don't think people, no matter how wrong
even
they are,
they're already suffering.
But there is a welfare state, kind
of.
So there are some like good things, like social things that
there's different
the
degrees
does.
Of suffering and it's hungry because their governments are being
but
elites.
is that the responsibility of the regime or is that the responsibility of the United States?
Whoever
the United
has an
States, but United States and the West, they have to think about nuclear weapons as well. We don't think about that as a threat as Iranians. And like when we see it's kind of like an
abusive boyfriend that is hitting his girlfriend like this is not you did this to yourself. I mean, when you know the consequences of your actions, even though somebody else did something wrong, you did cause those consequences, right? If you know the consequences of the action that you're taking, even though other people were also responsible
to it, responsibility away from the regime.
No,
and the,
you keep
the,
both
the,
responsible.
But the people of Iran
share responsibility
need to,
on hunger children.
Need to hold the regime responsible for what going on. Like whenever, even when the sanctions were going on, right, before Obama made the deal, the Iranian regime built a $10 million mosque in Denmark, right?
Yeah.
Fuck you if you're under sanctions, whatever.
But that's the government money. That's government money that they use. The thing is, when you put sanctions, you're taking away money from private companies
so
or private businesses.
You're not talking about, it sounds like both of these guys aren't talking about the same sanctions that you're talking about.
That was a sanction.
No, we are talking about Iranian sanctions.
Yeah, but
on
when you're
on private companies, private trade, all these big factories in Iran, all of them, right?
But it was focused on nuclear stuff, right?
They were using
the sanctions to get them to stop with the nuclear stuff.
Yeah.
It's like they're
tightening, but they were doing sanctions on the entire...
Right.
Yeah, but these are not just government entities. These are private companies.
Right.
There's like trade.
The whole country. Yeah.
But that is part of the theory, is that if you put sanctions on the people...
They will demand change.
They will ask the government to respond to the pressure.
This is kind of like...
They don't always do that. Sometimes they just get angry at the people with the sanctions.
It's like beating up innocent people so they demand change.
If you remember the election campaign, even though it wasn't a real election campaign, the election campaign between Rouhani and the other conservatives, right? Mm-hmm. They were talking, Rouhani was saying, you know, Ahmadinejad was at fault. Because of the sanctions, he was bad at being diplomatic, so that's why.
Even
Rouhani was saying, "You guys suck at diplomatics, so that's why we have the sanctions. That's why we don't have any deals." So
if you were a better deal maker.
Yeah, exactly.
you need a businessman.
Exactly.
Yeah. And that was kind of a progress because then actually you're looking at yourself and blaming yourself for something instead of always blaming the U.S. for...
It's kind of like going in and like thinking, oh, my neighbor doesn't have good security, and I keep telling you, change your security, and he's not listening to you. So I'm going to go beat up his child.
So that he understands how lax the security is.
I'm gonna go into his backyard and kidnap his child. So that's not how, I mean,
think about it from this way. When a country commits a bad action, right? So you have three choices. You don't do anything, you have sanctions, and you have war.
Yeah.
These are the three options you have. If you don't do anything, means that you are not punishing the country for bad actions. So let's say a country is a state sponsor of terrorism, like Iran and Saudi Arabia, whatever. If you don't do anything about it, it means you're literally giving them free pass. Then you have the war option, in which you bomb the shit out of them until you do a regime change and you overthrow. Mm-hmm. And then you have the sanctions option. There is no other options.
Well, what was the terrorism sanctions?
Well, there's
war
BDS.
And you're doing nothing. And doing nothing.
Yeah.
So if you don't do anything, you are literally letting just like Assad.
Okay,
Assad, for example, like people say, like, why did he bomb Assad? Like, okay, if you don't do anything, you're actually giving him a free pass.
ISIS is nothing next to Assad. I mean, Assad has killed so many more people.
Yeah, so like, if you don't punish him, then what it means is that he can literally do whatever he wants. He can do whatever he wants because you are literally giving him a free pass. So what do you have? Sanctions, war, and doing nothing.
And
there is no other option. So unless you advocate, if you are against the Iranian regime and you think sanctions don't work, then the other option is that you have to overthrow the regime. And that is the
Islam is always the biggest problem. The example I give is like, think about people that believe in zodiac signs and how it affects their personality, right? That by itself doesn't really harm anybody. But the same people that believe in that because they believe in something without evidence are the same people that don't believe that think vaccines cause autism, right? If you might look at, you know, why would I tell these people that zodiac signs and stars in the sky is not going to affect your belief system when it's not hurting anybody? Because you're teaching them that you don't believe in things without evidence. Because if they believe that, they're going to believe in something else down the road that is going to end up hurting them, right?
Yeah.
Because even if they don't hurt anybody, if they believe in things without demanding evidence, somebody's going to con them. Somebody's going to take advantage of them.
So if you're teaching them every Sunday or every Friday somewhere in a place of worship to believe all of this stuff without any evidence, then you're going to have a populace full of gullible people that are going to be willing.
You can't critically think. You don't question things. Just follow in line, you know.
Yeah, but when it comes to Islam, there's an ideological, juristic, political.
It's most definitely worse.
Yeah.
There's
it encompasses everything. I mean, how you shit.
We're not denying that it's worse, but we're saying that you can't, once you remove the critical thinking filter, then you lose control. You can't come farther down the road and try to steer them into a less harmful delusion. You have no control over that. The only time that you had control is teaching people critical thinking skills. Just because Islam is more harmful, you can't make them. There's no way for you to convince somebody that gets convinced by anything to go, you know, to become what other than critical thinking skills? What tools do you have to get people convinced to become Christians instead of Muslims, or to become a reform Muslim instead of Muslim? Because that's the only tool you have to offer, right? How are you, if somebody...
So you don't believe in reform?
No.
So you don't believe in reform?
No,
right?
I don't. I think that the problem was when you let the craziness out of the gates, then you completely lose control over where it lands.
Well, you know what's interesting about that? Because Sam Harris has this discussion about like moderates and reformers versus... He actually says that they're more dangerous because they don't understand what it means to truly believe, because they're cherry picking. Oh, you know, I take the nice stuff and I kind of believe in God. And
but that's not reforming, really. That's just not.
That's moderation.
Not believing. That's
right.
Not,
but some of it has to do with this reformed sense of, he was using Christianity in that sense.
Yeah.
You have these very extreme evangelical Christians. Then you have your just everyday Christian who, Jesus was a good guy, blah, blah, blah.
But
moderate.
Mainstream Christianity and mainstream Judaism were reformed,
right?
They were reformed, and at least they don't have the ideological.
Yeah, you are correct
no
in that
question.
Regard. Yeah, it's on a continuum.
The problem with Islam is that it hasn't
the mainstream Islam. I mean,
is
we have people like Aswan Wani, we have people... And
that she's not mainstream.
No.
Very
I'm saying, we have people like reforming people. And then we all through Islam's history, we've had these people like trying to reform Islam, right? But the mainstream Islam, no matter if it's Sunni, Shia, up and down, it's mainstream theology, mainstream stoning, mainstream.
Yes. Kill the gays.
I mean, the Enlightenment value has not reached the Muslim world to be a mainstream.
For years, they needed Enlightenment.
I mean, Europe. Well, I mean, Christianity. If you look at Christianity in Africa, if you look at Kenya and there was this other country, Uganda passed the Kill the Gay Bill.
The burning witches.
Yeah, the burning witches.
That's a direct result of the American Christians
but
coming
down again,
there.
It's a Christianity, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have the Russian Orthodox Church, which is trying to do cure therapy for homosexuality and stuff.
Right.
So you have the ultra-Orthodox Jews, right? The the Hasidics and
Haredi.
Haredi and all these people who have views about women and homosexuals that are deeply troubling, right?
Mm-hmm.
So... But the thing is, like, the Enlightenment or the moderate version of Christianity and Islam have made it to the mainstream. I mean, the Hasidics, they're crazy, but
they make up.
I mean, at the moment they make a fringe. They have babies. They have 12 babies per family.
Anyway,
but I think within probably, the likelihood that Israel is going to be destroyed by ultra-Orthodox Jews is much more likely than going to be destroyed by Hamas, because they breed like rabbits. And then
like a lot of the
Do they have
Muslims
four wives as well, like the Muslims?
Well,
no,
but they
have
12 children.
Babies,
yeah.
And they like a lot of Muslims. Many of them don't go to secular schools.
Yeah.
They don't engage with the rest of the community.
But if they leave their faith, will anybody come and kill them?
No one will come and kill them,
but they will
shun them. They will have
shunning every,
and
like,
no medicine. Like, if you're a woman, you know, you can't get services for your child, or your child can't go to school.
Really, in Israel?
In the community itself, outside of the community, no problem. But
you have to leave.
Yeah, you have to leave. You know, but.
We have it worse.
OIR. This is what oppression index rating. Your OIR has to be at a certain level before you're allowed to speak about anything.
I mean, back to something like the Enlightenment has made its way more strongly within Christianity and Judaism than it did with Islam.